going to continue on in the Gospel of John. John chapter 10 is where we are today. The 10th chapter of the Gospel of John, the unlike Gospel. It is so unlike anything that you find in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's just a totally different Gospel because it has a totally different thrust to it. And we're going to see today five different things that have to do with the number one that you will not find in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. However, these five things are the major themes of the church epistles. So in other words, the Gospel of John contains church truth. And that's what we'll be looking at today. Okay, let's have a word of prayer and we'll begin. Heavenly Father, we bow before you and thank you for our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that you would bless the study of your word today. Lord, we pray that you would give us hunger and appetite and desire to feed upon the word of God, that we might grow in it. And Lord, we do pray now that we might see a great moving within the hearts of your people to a great desire to know the Word of God and to understand the things of God, to comprehend spiritual truth, to not be content to be spoon-fed, but to dig out and search the Scriptures daily and to just enjoy the good things of God as they're revealed by your Holy Spirit. This is our prayer, Lord, and we ask these things in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, the five things that involve the number one are listed there at the top of the page. There's one way, there's one door, there's one shepherd, there's one sheepfold, and there is one voice. The one way is the one way into the sheepfold. The one door is the one door that enters into the sheepfold, and the one sheepfold is the sheepfold of God. And then there is one shepherd of that sheepfold, and there is one voice of that shepherd. These are all number ones that you will not find in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. You won't find the one way taught there. You will not find one door mentioned. You will not find one shepherd mentioned. Jesus is never even called a shepherd in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Nor is there even a mention of the sheepfold, nor of the voice of the shepherd. And so these things are all new revelations that are given in the Gospel of John. However, they are replete throughout the church epistles. They're not new as far as the church is concerned, but when Jesus gave them, they were brand new revelations. All right, let's begin to look at them together. And all of these have to do with church truth. Jesus did not teach church truth in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. He was ministering to the nation of Israel. But we come to the Gospel of John. It is filled with church truth. Now, the first church truth we're going to see here is there is one way, one way to God, one way of salvation, one way to be saved. And we find it, we don't have to read any farther than the first verse to find that. Notice in verse 1, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber." Notice he says, "but climbeth up some other way." He says there's a door to the sheepfold, and he that climbs up to get into the sheepfold, some other way. Because there's only one way, and that one way is the Lord Jesus Christ. In Acts 4:12, Peter said, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given amongst men whereby we must be saved." One way, that's it. Jesus himself said in the Gospel of John, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Now, I want to do a comparison with the words of Jesus from, we're going to look at Matthew and we're going to look at Luke, and then come back to the Gospel of John itself. But notice in your note sheets there, in Matthew chapter 19, we have nine things listed there, going on onto the next page. Notice number one, Matthew 19, 16 and 17. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? Isn't that something? That doesn't happen in a person's life very often. Where somebody walks up to you and says, How can I be saved? What can I do to have everlasting life? What do I have to do? What's the secret of it? I don't think that's happened to me more once or twice, you know, well over 50 years. And it happened to Jesus repeatedly. Now, what did Jesus answer to this man? Did Jesus give this man John 3:16? No. Did he give this man Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved? No. What did he say to him? He says, Why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, and that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, remember the question, what good thing shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? He says, if you would enter into life, keep the commandments. Is that what you would answer that man? Is that how you would answer him? I hope not, but that's how Jesus answered him. Why is that? Well, because he was talking to a different group of people that lived in a different time, in a different dispensation, and he had a different message to preach unto them. He's talking to Israel. And the gospel of the grace of God had not even been revealed yet. The Apostle Paul hadn't even got saved yet. And that was revealed to the Apostle Paul. No, Jesus is not giving him bad information. He's telling him for that economy, because they were living under the law, he says, you keep the commandments. Well, you see why it's so important? God put 2 Timothy 2:15 in the Bible for a very good reason. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. It is a result of studying the word of God. And I appreciated the pastor's message today, how Christians are so, he was talking primarily about serving God, but how Christians are, they don't want to be inconvenienced. They want to be entertained. They don't want to be inconvenienced. To study the word of God is going to involve inconveniencing yourself and to get so adept with it that you can rightly divide the word of truth is what the word of God exhorts us to do. Well, that's what Paul said, that we might be workmen that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. If you don't rightly divide the word of truth, suppose somebody came to you and said, what must I do to be saved? Would you tell him to keep the commandments? Jesus did, and that was the right message for that time, because they were still under the law. The age of grace hadn't even started yet. Nobody had ever heard of the church yet. That hadn't begun. So there was more than one way. Look at the same passage just a couple of verses later, Matthew 19, 20 and 21. The young man said unto him, All these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I yet? And Jesus said unto him, If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell all that thou hast and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me. He's talking to the same man. Lord, you still didn't give him John 3:16. He still wants to know what to do. He says, You told him to keep the commandments, and he says, I've kept the commandments. And he says, Yeah, you still lack one thing. You're too wealthy. Go and sell all that you have and give it to the poor. Is that the way of salvation? This is how Jesus was answering his question. Rightly dividing the word of truth. Don't tell that to somebody today that wants to be saved. You give them a false gospel. And then thirdly, in this same chapter, again, Matthew chapter 19, look at verse 29. And everyone that hath forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or fathers, or mothers, or wives, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive 100-fold, and shall inherit everlasting life. Wow, here's another way of salvation in response to this question that was asked here. Sell everything, give it all away, forsake everything. There has to be only one way, the Bible says. Jesus tells us here in John to climb up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But Jesus is listing here a number of other ways in response to the question of what shall I do to inherit eternal life. Now, number four there is from the Gospel of Luke. In Luke, he says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said unto him," he didn't put the verse in, but he says, "to keep the commandments." And he says, "Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live." Notice the word do. This do. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? Inheriting eternal life is not doing. You don't do anything. There's nothing you can do. It's already been done. And that is, Jesus has died on the cross for the sins of each and every one of us. And so he's not preaching heresy here at all. This is still under that economy of the law. And he's telling them, this is what you must do. The gospel of the grace of God that was revealed to the Apostle Paul hadn't even happened yet. It would be a number of years yet before this happened. Let's go to the next page, number five. Here we have it again. A certain ruler asked him, saying, "Good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And look at the answer Jesus gives him. It's the same as we had in Matthew. "Sell all that thou hast, distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." And so again, he mentions this again. And then number six in Matthew 5:9, Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." How do you become a child of God? By being a peacemaker? Whatever happened to John 1:12? "To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." The scripture teaches us that we become children of God by receiving Jesus as Savior. But Jesus tells this man, he says, "You be a peacemaker and you'll be called children of God." Folks, this is a totally different setting. And to take the message that Jesus was teaching to that generation of Jews and try to fit it into the church, the result is heresy. And this is what the liberals do. They love to dwell in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Pardon me. And to take that message and try to fit it into the church age today. You can't do that. It's a totally different situation. And Jesus is giving to them the gospel of the kingdom, and he's telling them what to do to enter into it. Look at number seven there. He says, "Except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven." Well, all I got to do to be saved then is to be more righteous than the scribes and the Pharisees. That's a tall order, but if that's what I got to do, okay, then I'll do it. No, that's not how you enter into heaven. You enter into heaven by believing that Jesus is the Son of God and he died on the cross for your sins. Look at number eight. This is where it really gets sticky. This is part of the Sermon on the Mount. Do you like the Sermon on the Mount? Well, the liberals love the Sermon on the Mount. But what they do is they pick and choose what they want out of the Sermon on the Mount. This one gets totally ignored. Believe me, it does. "If thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee." And he goes on and says, "If thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee." And he says, "It's more profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell." She said, what is Jesus telling them they have to do? Mutilate your body if you want to get to heaven. Now again, folks, this isn't the gospel of the grace of God. this is for that kingdom economy. He's showing them the need for obeying the law and the righteousness of God and the standard of that righteousness and how they could not keep it. And there was a blood sacrifice connected with it. I mean, this is Old Testament law teaching that Jesus was upholding here. Look at number 9. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. I've heard preachers preach, if you want God to forgive you, you've got to forgive other people. That's what Jesus taught here. Yeah, but the book of Ephesians, which was written to the church, says that we are to forgive people not in order to be forgiven. We are to forgive people because we're already forgiven in Jesus Christ. A totally different concept of forgiveness. So you see, when Jesus comes here in John chapter 10 and says there's only one way, and again in chapter 14 when he said, I am the way, this was a brand new concept. This is something they had never taught before. This is church truth. And it's the epistles, the church epistles are filled with it. But you don't find it in the synoptic gospels. So then, keep the commandments, sell everything you have and give your money to the poor, forsake your homes and your families, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and your neighbor as yourself, sell all, give it to the poor again, be a peacemaker, be more righteous than the scribes, cut off the offending body parts, and forgive others. These were all things that Jesus said in response of what should I do to inherit eternal life. Does that sound like one way? No, it doesn't. Because it was talking to a different group of people in a different time under a different economy. The age of the law, the Mosaic Old Testament law. So this is why we have to rightly divide the word of truth. Jesus said there is only one way. And that way is through him. And anybody today that preaches any other way is a heretic. Because there is only one way. And that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now not to a single one of these in these 9 examples does Jesus ever mention that he was going to die on the cross for their sins. Not one time does he say that, or even hint that he was going to die on the cross for their sins. See, that's the gospel. Christ died for our sins. He was buried and he rose again the third day. This is the preaching of the gospel. He died for our sins. He never mentions this to these folks. And you know, you can get religious today and you can talk about all kinds of religious things, and you can even talk about Jesus. You can even talk about the death of Jesus. But if it is not because of the fact that he died for your sins, you're not giving out the gospel of Jesus Christ. The whole purpose behind it was that Christ died for our sins. Now there's a movie that I know you've heard a lot about this, that's coming out, about this, The Passion of Christ, this Mel Gibson movie. I haven't seen it, don't know anything about it, and I don't know that I even will see it, but I want you to understand something. It's entertainment. That's what it is. It's entertainment. It's been produced, and he's to be commended for what he's doing, but it's still entertainment. Hollywood and that crowd cannot convey spiritual truth to anybody. So if you're going to go see it, and many of you will, don't expect spiritual truth. What you're going to get is entertainment. What you're going to get is emotion, a lot of emotion. That's what the whole thing is about, Jesus' death on the cross, a lot of emotion. Oh, it's going to be replete with emotions. But don't expect spiritual truth. See, emotion and spirituality are two different things, two completely different things. That's why when people, many times they come in front of the church afterwards and they're all bent out of shape with emotion. Many times there's nothing spiritual actually happening because it's just emotion. You know what emotion is? It's the flesh. It's the flesh. And so you can't gauge spirituality by the amount of emotion that is there. But what I started to say was, this whole movie is going to be about the death of Jesus on the cross. I will be very surprised. If you go see it, you can come and tell me I'm wrong. I will be very, very, very surprised if the message in that film is that Jesus' death on the cross was for my sins. And if it doesn't say that, it is pure entertainment, not spiritual truth. This is spiritual truth. Christ died for our sins. All right, let's go on then to the next page. One door. There's one way, and that one way is through one door. We have it three times. First of all, verse 1 again. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth in by the door, not a door, the door. Then we have it again in verse 7. Then said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door. Now the door is identified. There's only one door, and Jesus said, I am the door. And then finally, in verse 9, he says it again, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. There's one door into the sheepfold, and that door is Jesus, and that door is salvation. So three times here we have the door. Now in the Old Testament, people could not go in through the door. In the Old Testament, they were not allowed through the door. In the Old Testament, people could come up to the door, but could not enter in through the door, the entrance into God. Notice in your note sheets there in Ezekiel 46:3, likewise the people of the land shall worship at the door, not go through the door, because through the door was the Holy of Holies, which was the presence of God, and only the high priest once a year with a blood sacrifice could go through the door into the Holy of Holies, into God's presence. But the people had to stay outside. They could come up to the door, but they couldn't go through the door. In Mark chapter 1 and verse 33, it's talking about Zacharias there. It says, all the city were gathered together at the door. They were gathered at the door, couldn't come through the door. Jesus is the door. They couldn't come to the door. But in Hebrews 4:16, the scripture tells us to come boldly before the throne of grace. We are exhorted as Christians to not only go through the door, but to come into the very throne room of God. No Old Testament Jew, he would have recoiled in horror if anyone would have suggested to an Old Testament Jew that you can come up and enter into the throne room of God, into God's very presence. But this is what the church is exhorted to do, to come boldly before the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. What's the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament? The revelation that Jesus is the door, and he says, you enter in through the door. I am the door, and by me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. And it was Jesus that opened the door to the Gentiles. He opened the door to the Gentiles. The Gentiles were totally excluded. They weren't even allowed at the door of the temple. But we read in Acts chapter 14, it says, and when they were come and had gathered the church together, notice the church, not Israel, gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done unto them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. Who opened it? Jesus did. He had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me. 2 Corinthians, he says again, A door was opened unto me of the Lord. And in, again, in Colossians, he says, pray that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ. The door has been opened. First, we read in the Gospel of John that Jesus is the door. In the Synoptic Gospels, there's not even a door. And the door was the door of that is the door of the temple, and the people could only come up to the door. In the Gospel of John, we read that Jesus is the door. And then the church epistles, we read that not only is Jesus the door, but that door is wide open. That door is wide open and has been opened to us by the Lord himself. And here's an interesting verse at the top of the next page. In Psalm 84:10, I love this verse. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. I knew a man years ago, he's dead now. He was what looked like a hopeless alcoholic. And this man got saved. He became a dear brother in Christ. He was about 6'5", long, skinny frame. Clothes just kind of hung on him like they do on a coat hanger. He had no talents that anybody seemed to know of for much of anything, but he loved the Lord. And you saw him in church every Sunday. And he said, I can't teach, I can't preach, I can't sing, I can't do any of that stuff. But he says, I can be an usher. And as long as I knew that brother, he was an usher in the church. And he'd stand by the door. There was only one door into the church from the front there. He'd stand by that door with bulletins in his hands, and he'd pass out to and greet people when they came in. And this was his life verse. He says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. He said, I've dwelt in the tents of wickedness for a lot of years. He says, now I'm a doorkeeper in the house of God. Well, that door is Jesus. He's the door. That's a revelation that we get only from the Gospel of John. It's kind of like the ark. The ark just had one door also. Heaven has one door, and the ark had one door. That means that the ark was a type of heaven. It was a type of Christ. And that one door on the ark had to be wide enough so that two hippos could go in side by side. And it had to be high enough so that two giraffes could go in. It had to be tall enough to let them in. Man, those things are tall. You know what I did when I was in Arizona last week? I fed a giraffe. I did. It's a lot of fun to feed a giraffe. Those things are so tall. They got this big platform. It's about as high as the balcony up there. And the giraffes walk up to it, and their head is right there. Just imagine the giraffe is right here. His head would be up. Al could feed him up there from the computer. And you buy this little packets of stuff, you know, and they stick their tongue out, and you pour it on their tongue, and they slurp it down. Man, they are the strangest-looking creatures. Who says God doesn't have a sense of humor? When he made the giraffe, he had to have a sense of humor. But they're so tall. But the door of the ark was tall enough to let the giraffes in. And then the sill on that door was low enough so a couple of snakes could slither over it. In other words, that door was a perfect door. It's a picture of Christ. Anyone and everyone can come to Jesus and be saved. So we have one way and one door. And then thirdly, we have one shepherd. One shepherd. Verse 16 tells us, and other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. One shepherd. And who is that shepherd? Well, if you look back in verse 11, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Show me in Matthew, Mark, or Luke where the death of Christ is, we are told that the death of Christ is for the sheep. You don't read that. You don't read it. He died for our sins. That's what we were saying about that movie. I'd be very surprised if that message is in that film, that the purpose is to die for our sins. Well, anyways, at any rate, he's the one shepherd, and he calls himself here the good shepherd. And the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. That's gospel truth or church truth. And so he's the good shepherd. Then we also see him in the Word of God as the great shepherd, Hebrews chapter 13. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. And then he's also called the chief shepherd, 1 Peter 5:4, when the chief shepherd shall appear. So we have the good shepherd, the great shepherd, and the chief shepherd, all of which are the Lord Jesus Christ. So there is one shepherd and one shepherd only. Now, in the Word of God, the word shepherd is the same Greek word as pastor. A pastor is a shepherd. He's to shepherd the sheep. Now, in the Synoptic Gospels, Jesus, not even one time, is referred to as a shepherd. Not even once. But we come to the Gospel of John, and not only is he a shepherd, he's the good shepherd. Now, you contrast the shepherd here with the hireling. Look at verse 12. He that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming. So what does he do? He leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. Verse 13, the hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. There's a difference between a hireling and a shepherd. We're fortunate at Faith Baptist Church. We have a shepherd, an under-shepherd, and not a hireling. Many churches have hirelings. And you see what it says about the hireling. They careth not for the sheep. They don't care about the sheep. Trouble comes, and they're gone. And another thing about a hireling is they desire rewards. They're in it for the money. You read it, look in Job chapter 7, verse 2. As a servant earnestly desireth the shadow, and as a hireling looketh for the reward of his work. The hireling is out there for a reward. I knew a church that called a pastor. He agreed to come. And he said, let's talk about salary. They talked about salary for a while. And he said, that's not enough. I want more. And they talked some more and talked some more. Now, the church had an assistant pastor. And he says, well, you're going to have to pay me more than that or I'm not coming. And they said, well, there is no more to give you. And he says, fire the assistant. Give me his salary too. That man was a hireling. You know how long he lasted at that church? 6 months. And that was it. Look at the next two verses there. In Isaiah 21:16, for thus hath the Lord said unto me, within a year, according to the years of a hireling. They generally last between 1 year and 3 years. Isaiah 16:14, now the Lord hath spoken, saying, within 3 years as the years of a hireling. Between 1 and 3 years, and then they're gone. Why? Because Jesus said they careth not for the sheep. A good shepherd, a good pastor, cares for the sheep. He loves the sheep. There was a man many years ago, he was felt God called him into the ministry, and an elderly pastor came up to him, and he says, young man, you love to preach, don't you? He says, yes, I do. He says, I want to ask you another question. He says, I know you love to preach, but do you love those you preach to? There's the difference. The good shepherd loveth his sheep. He loves the sheep. Now, the Old Testament has a lot to say about pastors or shepherds. And if you look under number 5 there, it says, for the pastors are become brutish. This is Jeremiah 10:21. It says, the pastors are become brutish and have not sought the Lord. Therefore they shall not prosper, and all their flocks shall be scattered. And then in Jeremiah 12:10, it says, many pastors have destroyed my vineyard and have trodden my portion underfoot. They have made my pleasant portion a desolate wilderness. And then Jeremiah goes on again in chapter 23 and talks about these hireling pastors. He says, woe unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep. And in Jeremiah 23:2, he says, therefore, thus saith the Lord God of Israel against the pastors that feed my people, ye have scattered my flock, driven them away, and have not visited them. And so the Word of God has a lot to say about hireling type of pastors. Well, Jesus was the good shepherd, and then he mentions the hirelings, but then there's a third entity in this chapter, and that's the thief. And the thief is mentioned there in verse 1. Those that try to enter in some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. So you got the good shepherd, you got the hirelings, and you have the thief. So you can expect all three kinds populating churches today. The good shepherds, the ones that are shepherding God's people, caring for them. The hirelings, they care not for the sheep at all. And then you have the thieves, the ones that try in getting in some other way. They're not even saved. And yet they masquerade as the true believers. So the ministry is full of all kinds. Believe me, it really is. Okay, fourthly, one sheepfold. And here is one of the great passages in the Gospel of John that exemplify church truth. Verse 16. Jesus said, other sheep I have, which are not of this fold. They're not Jews. They're not of the nation of Israel. When the people Jesus is talking to here were all Jews, and they were all of the nation of Israel. But this is an astounding revelation. He says, I've got some other sheep, and they're not of this fold. Them also I must bring, that they shall hear my voice, and there shall be, here it is right here, one fold and one shepherd. That's the church. The church did not exist yet when Jesus spoke these words. But he predicted there would be one fold and one shepherd. Not a Jewish church and a Gentile church. One fold and one shepherd. Now this was radical theology in the days that Jesus was here upon the earth. But you read the church epistles, man, all Paul's epistles are filled with this great truth. We put just a few examples down here. On the last page of your notes there, look at Ephesians 3:6. He says that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body with the Jews. That is, the church began the Jewish Christians. And he says, Gentiles, he says, are all going to be part of that same body by the gospel. And then in Ephesians 2, he says that he might reconcile both being Jew and Gentile, unto God in one body, that's the church. How did he do it? By the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And then to these believers in Ephesus, he says in 2:19, now therefore ye, being Gentile believers, are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. On and on and on through the church epistles, it's the church is one body, one sheepfold altogether here. There's neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free, there's neither male nor female, for you're all one in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 12:13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles and so forth. That's church truth. And it was revealed for the first time by Jesus here in John chapter 10. And then we have the number 5, we have the one voice. And this voice is mentioned a number of times here in John chapter 10. The first time is in verse 4. It says, when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him. And look what it says, they know his voice. The sheep know the voice, his voice. Have you ever had a dog, and maybe the dog's down the street or something, you call him. Boy, that dog turns around, he comes running because he knows your voice. Other people can call that dog and he just totally ignores them. You ever notice that? The dog knows the voice of his master. Well, the sheep also know the voice of the shepherd. And that's why he's saying here, they know his voice. Jesus calls his sheep. They hear his voice. They don't just hear his voice, but they know his voice. And then look, if you will, also in verse 14. In verse 14, he says, I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. My sheep, I know my sheep. My sheep know me. And then again, in verse 16, other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice. They're going to hear my voice. They're going to recognize my voice. And then finally, in verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Now, throughout all of this, Jesus is saying over and over and over again that the true sheep recognize the voice of the shepherd. And this gives me some concern because look at verse 5. It says, a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. They know not the voice of strangers. And I'll tell you, this is an item of concern, that the sheep do not know the voice of strangers, but on the other hand, they do know the voice of the shepherd. Because I see professing Christians continuously led astray by other voices, maybe the cults or some of the charlatans on television that come along with a prosperity gospel and all that business. Christians, professing Christians, sit and listen to them and they can't tell the difference, and it sounds good and off they go following this one or that one and so forth. The voice that we're to recognize and understand is the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ. He putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him. They know his voice. And in verse 25 of chapter 5, verse 25, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. Even dead people, dead believers, recognize the voice of Jesus. Do you recognize the voice of Jesus when he speaks? You hear somebody preach or teach, can you recognize the difference? Whether it's the Word of God or some false gospel, some cult maybe, or some off-the-wall type of teaching. So much of it is out there. That's why we have to study to show ourselves approved unto God, rightly dividing the Word of truth, to know the Word of God, to understand the Word of God, to comprehend the Word of God, to rightly divide the Word of God, so that we don't follow some other voices. There's a lot of voices that are out there. And then we read also, Jesus said about his sheep, they shall hear my voice. True believers are going to hear the voice of Jesus. And that makes me wonder, you know, when you see professing Christians out after this voice or that voice, whatever it is, were they really saved? Jesus said, another voice they won't hear, but my voice they'll recognize. It's kind of upsetting sometimes. John chapter 10, verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And then the Bible, the last book of the Bible, again, Jesus exhorts people to hear his voice. He says to the church of Laodicea, behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and sup with him, and he with me. The last call of Jesus to his church is, you've got to know my voice. Here is the voice of God. This is God's voice. Can you tell this voice from other voices? Can you tell this voice from that of a stranger? or a hireling or a thief. There's all kinds of them out there. Well, we'll stop here. And if you need today's lessons, they're around here someplace. And all the back lessons are up here. And so if you need them, just avail yourself of them. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll be closed. Heavenly Father, thank you now for your voice. And Lord, I would pray that every person here might recognize that voice. And might it be a familiar voice. Lord, give us the gumption to study your word and to know the word of God and to read it and meditate on it, that we might recognize your voice above all others. Dismiss us with your blessing, we now pray in Jesus' name. Amen.